Welcome everyone to your next session at Coalesce. No silver bullets, building the analytics flywheel. I'm Julia Schottenstein and I'm part of the product team at DBT Labs and I'll be your host for this talk. In this talk, we'll hear from Aula Education Data Lead, Kelly Burdine. I love this talk so much because while software investments and more people on the data team will likely help improve a company's data capabilities, there's no one panacea. Kelly is going to talk about leaning into analytics engineering workflows and how that was a big unlock in accomplishing her team's goals. And actually, we're also joined by Erica Pullum and Lewis Davies, who are senior analytics engineers on the Aula team and will be hanging out in Slack to help answer questions. So if you'd like to contribute to the conversation, please join the DBT Slack channel, Coalesce Analytics Flywheel, and Kelly and her team will follow up there. So without further ado, Kelly, over to you.
Thanks, Julia. I'm super excited to be here. Julia said, I'm Kelly Burdine, and I'm the data lead at Aula. And Aula is an ed tech startup that builds a learning engagement platform for higher education. I've been at Aula for just over 2 years, but I've worked in data analytics for more than 10 years. I've had the opportunity to build out a data function from the ground up twice at two different organizations, including Aula. And what I've learned from my experience is that creating value for your organization by leveraging data is really challenging. There isn't an easy fix or a silver bullet, to quote my presentation title, to creating that value. But when I joined Aula 2 years ago, I was determined to do things differently. And the results were maybe even a bit more surprising than I had initially imagined. So today I'm going to walk through how I created what I'm calling the analytics flywheel that helps us build momentum so we can better tackle these challenges and give you some tips for incorporating this at your own organizations. Like Julia mentioned throughout this presentation, I'll actually be incorporating the perspectives of my entire team, and they'll be manning the Slack channel today to answer any of your questions. But first, we're gonna actually dive into my backstory just a little bit. So like I said, I've had the opportunity to be the first analytics hire at two different organizations now. And at my last company, I was a bit more naive on what it took to build out a really scalable and reliable data function. In fact, I thought that I had every piece of the puzzle I needed to be successful with really just a few simple tools. I had a centralized cloud data warehouse, asked some software engineers to dump our various data sources in there using custom ETL pipelines. We set up a modern cloud BI tool and gave access to all of our data to our entire data organization. I even created a couple training classes to teach employees how to query and visualize our data. Thinking a bit of data literacy was the last piece to achieving data democratization and self-service analytics. So here I was thinking I had everything I needed to be successful. And I was going to deliver all these powerful insights across the business to lower churn and increase conversion, improve the user experience, save money, et cetera. And for a short time, it worked. People had access to data they had never seen before. I was analyzing trends and delivering insights to company leaders. And it felt awesome. However, as our company and our team and our data volume grew, a lot of problems started to arise. And I'm guessing that a lot of you can probably relate to some of these problems. We would often have cases where data would suddenly go missing or be incorrect. It was difficult to clean and analyze the data quick enough to impact decision-making in our fast-moving and growing organization. Metrics and company-wide dashboards would suddenly change, and the problems were often first noticed by our stakeholders and not the data team, and we wouldn't even know why the numbers changed. Stakeholders were using different reports with different numbers for the same metrics, leaving everyone really confused. And as with most data, it's inherently messy and riddled with nuances. So everyone on my team was spending 90 to 100% of their time just cleaning, prepping, transforming data. This means almost 0% of the time was spent doing actual analysis and delivering insights to decision makers. So the results of all these problems is that most people in the organization didn't trust our data. They didn't want to self-service in any way. And everybody needed help from a data analyst, but analysts weren't available because they were completely bogged down by just cleaning data and fixing problems. So then the data request line starts to form, and eventually people really just get sick of waiting in line. And so they aren't going to use data for decision-making anymore. So then I came to this like really harsh reality that our team was more of a cost to our organization than an asset. And we just weren't producing enough value. And unfortunately, I see this situation all the time. These problems that I mentioned were also experienced by my other teammates at Aula and many other people that I've talked to at other organizations. And this happens in different industries, different size companies, and even in different countries. We're all seeing the same thing. And this happened a few years ago, but this is really still true today. Like earlier this year, the Harvard Business Review published a report saying virtually every Fortune 1000 company was investing in data, but only a quarter of them were actually thinking that they were actually data-driven. When I had this realization a few years ago, I really wanted to believe that there was that silver bullet solution. I tried adding more tools, I tried hiring more people, and I was constantly iterating on our sprint process. But everything I did just felt like this uphill battle, and I wasn't achieving any results. And so when I started analyzing these problems at a deeper level, I realized there's this common thread. We have a ton of processes that were really manual and repetitive, which didn't get better with more data, more people, or more tools. It was actually just making the problem more widespread. And these are the same problems that software engineering best practices resolve and where analytics engineering actually came from. And at the time, I knew about analytics engineering. I was part of the DBT Slack community. And I had even hired somebody with the title of analytics, but we weren't really doing it. I realized that analytics engineering, it wasn't just a title. It's not just a suite of tools. It's really more of like philosophy or practice that needed to be rooted in everything we did. So as I had this realization, I started developing my vision for doing things differently. And coincidentally, Aula approached me around the same time and asked me if I would come start and build out their data function. So I pitched them my vision and a high-level strategy, and they hired me. And so here was this excellent opportunity to really test my hypothesis of building out and running everything with an analytics engineering mindset. Plus, I had the added benefit of being able to iterate really quickly at a small company. And what I discovered was they actually created this flywheel effect. So for those not familiar with a flywheel, it's a mechanical device that takes some effort to put in motion, and initially it moves really slow, and that motion is hard to detect. But once it creates this energy, it gains momentum, which allows it to continually spin without needing to put much additional effort into it. And so I'd done all this effort up front at Aula and all these small steps, just building out and setting that foundation of infrastructure and best practices and processes of analytics engineering. And everything after that became so much easier. It didn't feel like an uphill battle anymore. And now we have all this momentum where we can just deliver on outcomes. And it's been, so comparing to what I've seen before and what we have at Aula now, we have accurate and reliable reporting. Our ingestion pipelines are robust and timely. When source data or business logic changes, we can handle those quickly and painlessly. And most importantly though, we have far more time to spend doing analysis and delivering insights. And most of our decision makers across the company are making real efforts to using data. And it really feels like we're just getting started, and the momentum is going to allow us to move even faster to do more incredible things. So hopefully by now, some of you are wondering like what I actually did at Aula to create this flywheel and what you can do to create one at your own organization. So there were really three high-level processes that I used at Aula that I think could be implemented at any organization. So the first one is getting organizational buy-in. Now I mentioned analytics engineer, I think it's more than just a title or a person. It's more than a set of tools. It's really an entire practice. And to really bring analytics engineering into the core of everything you do, it's going to require change. And for some teams, major change. So it'd be really difficult to do this all by yourself. So you're going to want some buy-in. And at first it might start off as just one person. Maybe it's the whole team. Maybe it's a wider organization. But you're going to need some buy-in. So the first thing that I did at Aula was identify an advocate that could back me up and really support my initiative. So an advocate is someone with one or more of the attributes listed on this slide. So for me, this was our VP of product. He had previously seen data be really powerful. He was disappointed that our product team wasn't making decisions based off of data, and they were working more off of output than outcomes. He wanted to be measuring objectives, and he wanted to be data-driven. He also, the bonus was he was part of the executive team. So he was able to help me convince others along the way to really support this initiative. So he was a great advocate. The next thing that I did and that everyone should do is really present the benefits to your organization and to your team, whoever you need to convince to make this happen. Okay, so This might be your line manager. Again, maybe it's your team, maybe it's somebody else. But a mistake I made early in my career was framing the problem instead of the benefits. I actually remember in my last organization going to our VP of engineering and telling him how difficult all of our analyst jobs were because our event logging pipeline was a hot mess. I showed him multiple examples of problems we had encountered and told him how much time we were spending addressing all these data problems. But what I didn't focus on was how having better event logging would have actually benefited our organization, because we would have had all this additional insight into how our product was getting used. And the solution would actually make it easier for engineers as well. So I learned from those lessons, luckily. And at Ala, when I made my pitches for resources or other types of support to build that analytics engineering foundation, I really focused on how it would benefit the business. I certainly had plenty of examples of problems in my back pocket that I could use if I needed to reiterate something, but that's not what I focused on. I really focused on being able to leverage data for better decision-making and self-service analytics. Those are some of the benefits that I really tried to clarify. Now, at this point, you haven't gained much momentum in your flywheel. In fact, it probably still feels like you're pushing that boulder uphill, but you're actually starting to inch forward and you're putting that wheel in motion, which is super critical. And to continue putting it in motion, the next thing you want to do is get a quick win. So find something small that you can do to quickly show some value. A common mistake is wanting to tackle a problem in its entirety with some ideal solution. This could take months to really reap the benefits, and you're still trying to get those around you on board. You need that momentum. So this is a similar approach to the concept of building a minimal viable product, where you want to build the smallest thing to be able to quickly test your assumptions, or in this case, show the value. So maybe this is something like adding automated tests to your most problematic model. Maybe this is moving one of your transformations into version control. Maybe it's switching one data product to a new tool. Just find something small that you're confident will show value so you can continue to get more organizational buy-in and continue to push that flywheel forward. Now, depending on the size of your organization or your position within the team, the process of pitching for support or asking for resources might not be worth it in the beginning. As Grace Hopper, a very famed computer scientist, once said, it's easier to ask forgiveness than it is to get permission. So maybe that small thing you build to show value is something you just tackle on the side and present back to the team. Showing something that you've already tried can be really powerful. You still want an advocate to help support you. And again, you don't want to go overboard here, but I've had reports do this over the years and show me some pretty amazing things that maybe we would have otherwise not prioritized. All right. So now at this point, you have the attention of some or all of your teammates and hopefully like a senior leader or someone else in the organization that can really help get support. You've proven out the value in a small dose, but what's next? How are you going to get there? Just like if you're pitching a new product on Shark Tank, right? You have to have a good plan for succeeding. You can't just say you have to have a plan for how to get there. You don't need to plan out the next 5 years, but what does say like the next 6 months look like? Collaborate together as a data team to build the roadmap so that everyone feels a sense of ownership. We actually did this recently at Ala to plan out our next phase of analytics maturity. We started by identifying our biggest problems. We brainstormed solutions together. We voted on the best options. We overlaid those on an impact matrix. And then we used that to prioritize and define our roadmap. And then we presented that back to our company to really, again, continue to get organizational buy-in to push that flywheel forward. So at this point in your process, you don't actually have a lot to show for all the work that you've done, but you've actually put in a lot of effort and you've moved your flywheel quite a bit. And now you're at that top where things are starting to get a little bit easier. So you really want to be able to start accumulating visible results so that you can gain that energy. All right. So the next thing that I focused on at Ala, and what I recommend that you do as well, is to start implementing the essential practices of analytics engineering, one piece at a time. So each of these should have a visible result and impact. And what do I mean by essential practices? All of the core processes and best practices and tools that really comprise analytics engineering. I've listed some of the most common ones here, but this list is definitely not exhaustive. DBT Labs gave a couple of talks this morning around this topic. So I definitely encourage you to check those out if you're newer to analytics engineering. But this is where you can really build out that analytics engineering foundation and start to deliver visible results so that flywheel can start moving a little bit faster. Now, at Owla, I had the benefit of starting from scratch. So I was able to set a lot of this up from the beginning. But what was tricky for me was making sure that I had the buy-in from leadership to take that extra time up front to get it right, but also continuing to make sure I was delivering value along the way. I couldn't simply ignore the data needs of the business. It took a lot of effort to get organizational buy-in. So if you lose that buy-in because you're not delivering any value along the way, you lose your momentum. And it's crucial to deliver value along the way because you have to have that momentum to keep the flywheel going. So for me, I focused on implementing a lot of engineering or analytics engineering best practices within a small subset of data. If I tried doing it for all of our data, it would have taken a very long time to get to the point where business users could even start using the data. In fact, I probably would still be working on it, would not be here at Coalesce talking to you about it today. So the way I did this and figured out what data set to work on first is that I gathered input from the leadership team. I chose like the top business question or few questions that we wanted to answer. And for Owl, these questions were around users and whether or not they were taking certain actions within our product. There's a few key actions they were really concerned about. And so using that, I was able to create just like a handful of high quality data models using all the best practices that I knew to help answer those questions. Then I trained several end users on how to use those models so they could self-serve a lot of their questions and I could go back to focusing on implementing more essential practices and more data. And this process worked really well and allowed me to quickly accumulate visible results and gain momentum in my flywheel. Now, this process might not work as well if you aren't starting from scratch. So what can those data teams do? So my teammates in Slack are ready to share some of their best stories for implementing essential practices on existing teams and organizations. But let's take a look at just a couple of quick examples. So let's say that you want to get more collaboration in your code, okay? You could start by just adding a review step in your process that every deliverable has to go through. This is especially helpful for those orgs with a very decentralized data structure or a process that feels very siloed. And so honestly, at first, this is going to feel like a time suck to your analysts and your engineers. So you're going to have to hold people accountable so they stick to it. But what starts to happen is that you start catching problems during that review process that you would have otherwise missed. And this prevents rework, which takes more time than just doing a review up front. It also prevents stakeholders losing trust when they stumble upon a problem that you missed. And this is really crucial. Another example is testing. Let's say you don't have a lot of testing in your scripts and everything. And so you want to implement more testing, right? And to get testing everywhere, it's going to take some time. But you could just start off by having a hard rule that any model or script that gets touched or modified in any way, you know, gets a test added to it. By chipping away at it like that, you end up having a fairly robust test coverage in just a few. Let's say you have a lot of very large scripts or transformations or something like that, and you really want to get more modular with your code so things are easier to modify and test and everything else. So for this, you could really collaborate with your team by identifying, say, one particular script or model that you can break apart. We actually did this at my last organization where we had this crucial model that powered a ton of reports. And of course it was like hundreds of lines of SQL. And so nobody wanted to touch it. It was really intimidating. You couldn't even find where problems were. It was really difficult to work with. And so we started by just working together and identifying what's the easiest way we can chunk it up into a few pieces. And then from there, you take each of those pieces and you can chunk it up more. And so we work together that way to kind of create these much more manageable set of transformation scripts. And then that process by collaborating together taught people, how do we do this? What is the right process for this so that we can continue doing that? Now, each essential practice that you implement probably doesn't have a massive impact on your team by itself. But little by little, they combine to create some very meaningful impacts. So at this point, you've probably accumulated a lot of visible results and the team and maybe even the wider organization is starting to gain new positive energy from these results. And so this is where you can really start to gain more momentum. And to do that, you really need to get that flywheel spinning by hiring the right people as you grow your team and backfill your positions. Now, I don't mean to imply that you can't hire anybody until your organization is bought in and you've implemented all the practices, right? Remember, this is a wheel. This is a very cyclical process, so it really could come at any point. At my last organization, I mentioned that I definitely tried throwing people at problems, okay? And sometimes we'd hire people that had experience with the exact problems that we were experiencing, and they weren't always bought in to the analytics engineering mindset. So when we brought them in, they couldn't meaningfully contribute to the momentum and struggled along with the rest of us on the existing problems we had. They couldn't really solve them. And so I discovered that prioritizing hiring somebody with the right mindset over someone that has extensive experience in maybe your specific tool set or stack or something like that can actually lead to more momentum. Now, I don't mean to say that you can just hire somebody, anybody. Obviously, there is a minimum level of competency or technical aptitude that's needed for a position, but I found it much easier to teach somebody Python or how to use a different data warehouse or something like that than it is to convince them to adopt an analytics engineering mindset. And hiring right now is really hard. There just aren't enough people out there with these skill sets. Although hopefully at the end of this week, the pool gets a lot bigger, but expect to have to actively recruit individuals to join your team and be willing to look for people from other industries, other tech stacks. One of my colleagues who I hired hadn't used many modern data tools before, including DBT, but she believed in that analytics engineering best practices and had gone above and beyond at her previous organization to implement many of these practices using other means. And adding her mindset to the team gave us a ton of momentum and helped us to continue to implement and enforce those essential practices. And I believe there's some other talks this week talking specifically about hiring, so I definitely check those out. Now, once you get more people in your team with this mindset, you'll gain momentum quickly. You now have more people building that buy-in. You're implementing better processes faster. You can continue this process like a cycle to keep furthering your analytics maturity and spreading to maybe other data teams if you're a large company or other departments. And pretty soon you have this analytics flywheel that it just spins and no longer takes these monumental efforts to tackle new data challenges within your company that deliver a ton of value. So in conclusion, to increase the value of your data team, it's important to really build a solid analytics engineering foundation. And that will help you gain this momentum and create this flywheel. But to do that, you have to get organizational buy-in. You have to break apart those best practices and chip away at it piece by piece while continuing to deliver value and showing results along the way and hiring the people with the right mindset. And if you do that, you'll have an analytics flywheel and everything else will be easier. Thank you.